of the good Samaritan food pantry is always in need of canned fruit, meat, vegetables, non-perishable items. So please consider picking up a few cans on your next shopping trip. Drop them to them in the back, and we'll be sure to get to the food pantry for you. And also, don't forget to pick up some items for the community in action, the hygiene items. I'm sure teachers really appreciate that. And our Bible study scripture for this week will be Luke chapter 17, verses 11 to 17. All right. And for my call to worship, since we're doing all the Thanksgiving songs this week, and this is November, I found a little poem that I thought I'd share with you. And it's called Fill Your Heart with Thanksgiving. And it goes like this: take nothing for granted for whatever you do. The joy of enjoying is lessened for you. We rob our own lives much more than we know. When we fail to respond or in any way show, our thanks for the blessings that daily are ours, the warmth of the sun, the fragrance of flowers, the beauty of twilight, the freshness of dawn, the coolness of dew on a green velvet lawn, the kind little deeds so thoughtfully done, the favors of friends, and the love of someone. Unselfishly gives us in a multitude of ways, expecting no payment and no word of praise.
that was taken, and then we went to lunch, and then leftovers for to eat for the week. And one of the cadets, I believe he was the leader of the class, stood up and said that while they're there, they don't get many opportunities to get home cookies. So it was a wonderful thing for them. They said that they were able to have that home cooked meal and just be thought of while they're away from their families. They still have about 4 weeks left before they graduate, so we do have cards and maps for anybody who would like to send one. And then Millhouse is doing okay. There was a little bit of congestion yesterday, so they did a chest x-ray, but when I talked to John this morning, brought home, and they are now part of the eternal church triumphant. We celebrate the day that we called home, Heavenly Father, and they are now part of the great cloud of witnesses that we read in 1 Thessalonians that will bear us all away to heaven. But we will be in the presence of Jesus Christ. So we pray, Heavenly Father, as we gather today and we remember our saints. Pray that we remember their lives, how they lived, how they encouraged us to live, and that forever we celebrate they have been called home. There are so many things this week, Heavenly Father, in our lives and the life of the church that have given us reason to rejoice, that we were able to feed the police cadets, Heavenly Father, on Monday and share with them a time of devotion, friendship, and fellowship. Give you our thanks. For the time even on Tuesday with trick-or-treating, we were able to see little kids out in their costumes and just enjoy the night of football team, and to enjoy seeing children dress up. We give you our thanks and praise. We praise you, dear God, for every other good and wonderful thing that has happened in our lives, not just this past week, but the entirety of our lives. But we know, dear God, that you truly are the giver of every good and perfect gift. And we thank you for the gifts you have given to us. We pray, dear God, that we would be faithful stewards of those gifts, that we would use them to help bring joy to other people's lives. We pray before you, dear God, and we lift up those names that were spoken out loud this morning. We pray especially for those who have lost loved ones, that they take comfort from knowing that it is but a temporary separation and that their loved ones have been brought home to you. There are no more pain, there's no more sorrow for them. We pray, Heavenly Father, for those who are recovering from illnesses or have tested diagnoses that they're not sure with how to cope. We pray for your peace to be among them, help them to calm their fears and their anxieties. Not She touched our lives. One of the stories I remember sharing with her daughter, Donna Marie, I was laughing and said it was so funny. It didn't matter where you were. If you were with Donna Gale and it was time to eat, you were going to Cracker Barrel. And I said, I remember that she had a map of Kentucky in the glove box of her car, and it didn't list exit signs and road signs. In fact, it actually listed every location of Cracker Barrel across Kentucky. And she would pull the map out of the glove box, figure out where we were, figure out which one was closest, and that's where we would go. And her grandson Chandler was standing there when I was telling this, and he turned and looked at his mom and said, Mama had a map of what in the glove box of her car? Because he had never seen it. But last Sunday, then after the visitation, Michael and I, in remembrance of Donna Gale, went to Cracker Barrel and had dinner. But Donna Gale is now one of my saints. And today we celebrate All Saints Sunday. It's a service of remembrance. We give thanks to God for the lives of those who touched our life. People who were our family, our friends, loved ones, and colleagues who have now gone home and are part of the eternal church triumphant. And as we worship today, we are reminded of God's promise to resurrect all of those who believe in Him as the maker of heaven and earth, and in His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We remember those who have lived and died in the Lord, families, friends, and loved ones, that again, while we know they are gone, we know that they will forever be near and dear to our hearts. And while we remember them today specifically, it's also a day of celebration. We celebrate their lives. We celebrate that they have, in fact, been called home. And we celebrate that our hope in the resurrection is not in vain. It is a celebration of our hope that one day the resurrected Christ will return for all of His people, just as the Scriptures promise it happens, and that we will be reunited with all of our saints who have gone on. So on this day, we worship God for the great and wonderful gifts He has given to us, for our health, our family, our friends, and our faith, and for the saints who have touched our lives. We celebrate our saints and the difference they made in our lives and in the world around us. We remember them, and we give thanks that they were a presence in our lives. What a blessing our lives have been because of the wonderful saints who graced us with their presence. We all know the saints that we had, and they embodied everything that was good and kind. Saints who showed through their faith that Christ was with them in every aspect. Saints who truly made the world a better place because for a very short while they were part of God's creation and yes, part of our lives. We celebrate that we would not be the people we are today without their influence. The saints who reminded us what we are capable of doing and being and doing when the occasion called for gave us the swift kick in the rear that we needed. The saints who reminded us that when we followed their lead, which was their lead to follow the Lord, and when we allow Christ to work in us and through us, there isn't anything we cannot do. We are shown by our saints how to be a saint for another person. So we give thanks to God for our faith in the saints who have gone before. Those people who dedicated their lives to the Lord and in all things trusted in God. As we read today from the Revelation of John, we are shown the faith of our saints and the faith of all other saints who have gone before. In verse 9, it reads, they were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. The ideology behind this verse being that they, the saints, they have been made clean. Now, this isn't a new concept for us to be reading about. In fact, Psalm 51 reads, wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore me to the joy of your salvation and grant to me a willing spirit. Sustain me and wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. And from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, it says, you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. When we are born, we are physically and spiritually clean, but as we grow as the children of God, over time, we become spiritually unclean. We allow ourselves to sin, and every time we sin, we tar our souls just a little bit. We allow the secular world to dictate our thoughts, our words, and our actions, and we get clean. In verse 15, it reads, "Therefore, there before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple, and he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence." Our saints are now seeing the Lord face to face. You know, when Job was being tested and he was sitting up all the mountains and lamenting what had happened in his life, his so-called friends were there. They weren't really that encouraging. And they just kept telling Job that the only thing he should do was just curse God. But Job refused to do so. And in verse 19, Job says, "In my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I am not another." And again in 1 Corinthians it reads, "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but when I will know fully, just as I have been fully known." Our saints, not only have they been washed clean, their sins forgiven, but we are told they're in the very presence of God, seeing him face to face. As Job proclaimed, he will look upon God with his own eyes. And as Paul writes, what we see now, it is like looking in a foggy mirror. We only see part of the whole. But our saints with their own eyes are fully seeing God. Not a picture, not some other representation. They are not looking through a two-way mirror or some foggy mirror version, but the full, clear person of God. You know, we see commercials for universities which advertise that just because the university has a large student population, there is still an intimacy between the student body and the professors. And several years ago, there was a university, and I think it was University of Phoenix, and their taglines used to say, "Here, you are more than just a number." At the beginning of the scripture passage, John says there were so many white-robed martyrs and saints that he could not even begin to comprehend a number. But to God, we are more than just a number. And when our saints arrived at those heavenly gates, they were not greeted by a welcoming committee or some butler who tried to show them the way in. They were welcomed by God himself. He looked them in the eyes. He knew their name, the number of hairs on their head. He personally greeted them. And now our saints are seeing God with their own eyes. And they are praising him for his great and mighty acts that were manifest in their lives and in the world around them. Our saints are seeing God. And that is something to be praised. And finally, in verse 16 and 17, it says, "Never again will they hunger, never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Our saints, while they were living in this mortal flesh, they had aches and pains. They experienced illnesses, weaknesses, sadness, grief, and loss. But not so anymore. Whatever it is that ailed them while they were living, our saints have been brought to healing and wholeness. They have been made complete by the God who created them and redeemed them and who will now eternally sustain them. Our saints have been made new. In 1 Peter it says, "The God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you." We celebrate that our saints are in the eternal glory, that they have been restored, and that they have been strengthened. This should bring us so much hope as we remember when we think about what it is that they suffered through, how life tormented them at times. But we know that now they are not suffering. They are not being tormented, but are in the very presence of God, having been brought to healing and wholeness, and have been brought to him in holiness. We glory in our God, but we also glory in our saints, who, yes, have been separated from us for just a little while, but who now we know are part of the great cloud of witnesses. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our saints who have gone before us. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that while we miss them, we celebrate their lives, we celebrate that they have been called home. And we do our best to live in the example that they show to us all, and that we live in the example of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, whose resurrection we continue to wait. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen. So reading from the chalice order of worship, All Saints Day is a time to rejoice in all who through the ages have faithfully served the Lord. The day reminds us that we are part of one continuing living communion of saints. It is a time to claim our kinship with the glorious company of apostles, the noble fellowship of prophets, and the white-robed army of martyrs. It is a time to express our gratitude for all who in the ages of darkness kept the faith, for those who have taken the gospel to the ends of the earth, for prophetic voices who have called the church to be faithful in life and in service, and for all who have witnessed to God's justice and peace in every nation. To rejoice with the faithful of every generation expands our awareness of the great company of witnesses above and around us like a cloud. It lifts us out of preoccupation with our own immediate situation and the discouragements of the present. In the knowledge that others have persevered, we are encouraged to endure against all odds, reminded that God was with the faithful in the past, and we are reassured that God is with us today, moving us in all creation toward God and time. In this context, it is appropriate for a congregation to remember All Saints' Day, to commemorate the lives of those who died during the previous year. From Ephesians 1, it reads, I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all of the saints. For this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above rule and authority and power and dominion and above every name, not only in this age, but in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Let us pray. Eternal God, make us this day to remember the unseen cloud of witnesses who compass us about, who in every age and generation witness to their faith in life and in death. Those who by their courage and sacrifice won for us the freedom and liberty we enjoy. Those who serve their brothers and sisters at the cost of pain, of persecution, and of death. Those for whom all the trumpets sounded as they passed over to the other side. Those whom we have loved and have gone to be with you and whose names are written on our hearts. Help us walk worthy of those in whose unseen presence life is lived. Help us to have in our lives their courage in danger, their steadfastness in trial, their perseverance in difficulty, their loyalty when loyalty is costly, the love which nothing can change, and their joy which nothing can take away. Grant to us in your good time to share with them the blessedness of your near presence, that we may also come to that life where all the questions are answered, where all the tears are wiped away, where all shall be again, never to be separated, those whom we have loved and lost, where we will forever be with our Lord. Grant to us in this life never to forget those who have gone before, so that in the life to come we may share their blessedness through Jesus Christ our Lord.
and all that you please bless us, friend. Bless us in all that we do, for we know that all things come through you and guide you in this world. In your son's name, I pray.
As often as you eat of this bread and you drink of this cup, you proclaim the living Lord's death until he comes again in glory. Let us pray for the offerings. Gracious God, we give to you out of love and devotion to you the gifts of our tithes and our offerings. We pray, Heavenly Father, that as we give these gifts to you, they might be blessed and multiplied, that it might be used to help build up your kingdom upon this earth, so that in the name of Jesus Christ, every knee shall bow and tongue confess to Jesus Christ as Lord, the glory of God the Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Good job.